Yeah.
Aye, Stephen.
Aye, sadly, the level isn't.
That's an amazing title. Well, how about introducing Adrian to you from the University of Calgary, who has an amazing title, but very long, so I couldn't recite it. Please, you have the floor.
We'll get to the title in a second. I'll start by telling you the story. The Aboriginal people of Australia, the Indigenous people, have a story about a young duck named Feral Cool. So she's a very impetuous duck and doesn't obey her mother very often. So one of her mother's instructions are to never go upstream, never go up the stream, because up there there's a big mean water rat named Baboon. And Feral Cool's mother says to her, don't go up there because Baboon is a very, very mean rat and he will have his way with you if you go up there. Being an impetuous young duck, of course, this, if anything, made Feral Cool more interested in going up the road. So she does, and lo and behold, Baboon ravishes her. As a result of this, this young duck becomes pregnant and gives birth, of course, to a duck called platypus. Right? So a platypus is this very strange animal in Australia that is kind of a bit like a duck and kind of a bit like a water rat. So this is a sort of just-so story that explains how this animal came about. That story will be very relevant in about half an hour. Now, if this story is supposed to tell us about the origination of not just extant platypuses, the platypuses we currently have in Australia, but extinct platypuses, then Feral Cool and Baboon must have been enormous. Because here is Feral Cool, a Gyrodong Theroxul child, named after Feral Cool, who's a platypus that lived about 15 million years ago and is very, very big. So your standard platypus is perhaps that big, maybe 30 centimeters. Theroxul child was getting to about that big, about a meter. So big that the media, of course, dubbed her Platyzilla, which is cute. Now, there's a few things besides just being really big that is different about Theroxul child and modern platypus. One difference, as you can see there, is she has teeth into adulthood. Platypuses these days lose their teeth before they mature. And this tells us that Feral Cool's child had a different diet. So they suppose that perhaps they ate soft-shelled turtles, as we see here. So we have this extremely rich picture of this animal that lived 15 million years ago, which is really surprising given that this is the sum and total remains we have of this animal, a single molar. So on the basis of a single tooth, paleontologists are able to tell us an enormous amount of stuff about this platypus, which is, I think, quite remarkable. I'll give you a quick story about some of the ways that they can tell us. The first thing we should learn a bit about is a bit about mammalian teeth. So here's a lower molar on a mammal. You notice we've got two structures here, the trigonid and the talonid basin. Roughly, the trigonid is a structure on the lower molar, and the talonid basin is a structure on the higher, the molar on the top of the jaw. These slot in together, right? In platypuses and only platypuses, the talonid and the trigonid are the same length. So as you can see here, they're different lengths, so we know that this isn't a platypus. And so if you find a molar that has that symmetry, then you know you've got yourself a platypus. So that's how we know from this molar that Gyrodong Theroxul child is that kind of animal. We can get an idea of its size by comparing the molar of Theroxul child to other extinct platypuses who also kept their teeth into adulthood. This is Dickinsoni on the right here. Turns out, if you're a mammal, the size of your tooth tracks your body size pretty regularly. And so, by comparing Dickinsoni to Theroxul child, we can get an idea of how big she was. And moreover, this tells us pretty explicitly that this is not the same kind of species, because the range of variation in size in platypuses doesn't allow for there to be an animal which is, you know, as small as Dickinsoni and as big as Theroxul child. And so there are these features that we can use of mammalian teeth to get an enormous amount of information about the past. And that's what I'm kind of interested in exploring. Now notice the kind of inference that was just made. We went from a trace, some remain of the animal, to an animal in the deep past, right? So a fossil is something in the past. And that's a very common way of thinking about historical inferences. When people talk about evidence in historical science, they almost always restrict their discussion to talk about traces. This talk is part of a sort of broader set of work where I'm interested in challenging that idea. I'm interested in saying, look, the resources that historical scientists have are much, much richer. And if we just focus on traces, like we just did with Abdurrahman and Eric Schoolchild, we're going to miss the power of historical science. And this matters because historical science is extremely successful, especially considering the fact that a lot of the time they're working with things like single molars. And so I'm interested in providing a philosophical explanation of that success. And you do this by looking at the method. Right? What is it that historical scientists do? Most people, as I said, tend to think about method in that trace-based kind of way. Today, I'm going to be talking about the role of coherency instead. I think that there's a way that historical scientists link up the things in the past. They provide coherent narratives, which plays an incredibly important role in how they reconstruct the past. The title, Hot-Blooded Gluttons, will become clear when I get to my case study. I'm going to make three claims. The first claim is a descriptive claim. This is just about what historical scientists happen to do. I'm going to argue that coherency does play a role in historical reconstruction. I'm also going to make a normative claim. I'm going to argue that this coherence in historical reconstruction is evidential. That is to say, this isn't just a thing they happen to do, it's a thing that they ought to do. I'm finally going to make a claim about method. Most people, when they're considering the historical sciences, think about them in a sort of a monist kind of way. They tend to say, there is a way of being an historical scientist. When you're an historical scientist, you use trace-based reasoning, or something like that. I think that's a mistake. I think that historical scientists are actually what I'm going to call methodological omnivores, which is to say, they use whatever method they can to try and reconstruct the past. So there's no one way of being an historical scientist. So I'm going to start out by giving you a case study, which we'll meet the hot blooded gluttons. I'm then going to move into a discussion of the nature of historical evidence and the nature of explanation, and then at the end, I'll talk about method. I'll make this argument about methodological omnivory. And so, of course, in the first section, we'll see the descriptive claim, second section, the normative claim, and third, the claim about method. Let's go. So the example I'm going to use is from dinosaur paleontology. Now, most people think that dinosaurs are very, very big, right? This is the sort of standard view on dinosaurs. But it turns out that dinosaurs actually aren't really all that big, most of them. If you would go and take random samples of various dinosaurs, it would turn out that they're about the same size as we'd expect given mammals, which is kind of disappointing. But there are two exceptions. One are some of the theropods, these are the big Tyrannosaurus rexi guys, and the other ones that I'm going to focus on are the sauropods. So these are the long-necked, long-tailed, kind of big fat things like Diplodocus or Brachiosaurus. These things are extremely big. For example, here is, I believe it's this part of the leg. This is from a bone dig in Argentina. This is Argentinosaurus, which is probably the biggest sauropod we have at the moment. There's more cases of small people with large bones. This thing they reckon was about getting towards 30 meters long, so it's about as long as a whale, and weighed somewhere between, say, 40 to 70 tons. Right, their weight estimates are extremely wide. Now, what's interesting about this is that no other terrestrial animal has managed to get anywhere near this big. So the biggest that mammals have managed is Parasitherium, who is about 20 ton and 12 meters long. So Parasitherium, 12 meters long versus up to 30 meters long, 20 tons versus, say, 50 tons. And there's this mystery. How did sauropods managed to get so much bigger than mammals did? And this is kind of underlies this really rich research program where they're asking various questions about sauropod gigantism. Today, I'm going to focus on their thermoregulation, so whether they're hot-blooded or cold-blooded. So an endothermic or hot-blooded animal, warm-blooded animal, like ourselves, have internal furnaces that regulate their body temperature, right? We keep ourselves nice and toasty by, you know, using blood and so forth. If you're an endothermic, cold-blooded animal, you rely on external sources to keep yourself nice and warm, maybe not too warm. And having an endothermic thermoregulation system, in other words, being hot-blooded, is really important if you want to have a high metabolic rate. And we know that sauropods had a high metabolic rate because they grew so fast. So a sauropod, when it hatches, is about 5 kilos, and when it's fully grown, it's about 50,000 kilos. So we know they grew really, really, really fast. And it turns out the cold-blooded animals can't grow very fast, right? So as Gansett et al. Put it, there's just no way for giant sauropods to reach a total body mass of about 50 metric tons in a reasonable lifetime without having, at least partially during their lifespan, a high resting metabolic rate comparable to or even higher than that in mammals, right? So we can infer from how fast they're growing to them being endothermic. But this raises a problem, and this is what our focus is going to be. Here's the biggest endothermic land animal at the moment, African elephant. So she weighs 5 ton, eats about 100 kilos of food per day, and spends 16 hours foraging. Hopefully you can see what the problem is. If a 5 ton animal spends 16 hours per day foraging, how would a 50 ton animal find enough time? Right? That's a problem. This is where we get to explain the title. It seems as if we can infer from sauropods being hot-blooded that they must have been gluttons, which is to say, if they're endothermic, there must have been a way that they're able to eat more food at less cost, more efficiency, than mammals are. And so I'm going to look at an attempt to explain this. So this is from Sandra and Klaus back in 2008. Sandra and Klaus explain how sauropods could be gluttons in reference to a sort of network of sauropod features. The first two are the fact that sauropods don't chew and that sauropods have long necks. Now, when you're a mammal, you have to chew the food, right? If you're a sauropod, you don't chew, so you can eat more food more quickly. It's kind of straightforward. The long neck is important because it allows you to reach more food without having to move around a lot. So there's a really lovely paper which compares this to vacuum cleaners. So these days, vacuum cleaners are quite small bodies, and you drag the vacuum cleaner along, right? A long time ago, before we had kind of the technology to produce sort of small structures that have that much suction, the sort of vacuum cleaner body was monstrous. And so the design ended up having this big body that you haul into the middle of the room with a very, very, very long nozzle, right? And this allowed you to do a whole lot of vacuuming without having to move this giant thing. Same principle here. If you're a sauropod, you don't have to drag this 50-ton body around. You just sit there with this long neck and just eat lots of food. And so not chewing allows you to maximize your intake. Long neck means that it's going to cost you less, right? You can be more efficient. And that's really important if you want to be really big, right? Being able to eat this much food allows sauropods to be gigantic. And that's really good, because they need to be really big in order to house these huge digestive systems they have. If you're a sauropod, you spend a lot of time digesting. Why do you need to do that? Well, because you don't chew. Right? If you like mammals, when we're chewing, we're basically outsourcing our digestion, right? When you're chewing your food, what you're doing is you're breaking down your food, right? And that makes it easier for your gut. If you're a sauropod, you don't have that mitigation. And so all the food you're sucking in is getting just kind of all the digestion is being done in-house. This makes the analog with the vacuum cleaner, I think, quite strong. There's another interesting relation here, which is that not chewing is necessary to have a long neck. Because if you're like mammals, and we have these fancy teeth, that restricts how small our heads can be relative to our bodies, right? And if you're going to have a long neck, you want to have a small head, right? Because if you've got a great big head, this kind of is going to make it physiologically difficult. And in fact, if you've ever seen a giraffe trying to do almost anything, this gives you a good idea of how difficult it is to have a long neck when you're a mammal. Sauropods have tiny little heads, right? A sauropod head is about the same size as a horse's head. And you think about that on a 30-meter-long animal, you can see that these guys have got very small heads. That's necessary for them to have a long neck. So, how do sauropods eat more than mammals? Well, they don't chew, and that means they can take in more food more quickly. It also means they can have a small head, which allows them to have a long neck. Not chewing and having a long neck enables them to be really, really big, which is good because they need to be really big in order to house their digestive system, and that mitigates the cost of not chewing. Kind of a fun explanation. Now think about the relationship between that network and endothermy. Right? It seems as if there's a very strong relationship between what my credence should be in this network and what my credence should be in endothermy. I have independent evidence for endothermy. Remember, We know how fast they grow, and we know that only endotherms grow that fast. We also have independent evidence for this whole network. I haven't gone into any of the details, but I can do if you want. We know that they're gigantic because we have bones, so on and so forth. But in combination, it seems, the evidence I have for endothermy should increase my credence in that whole network, and vice versa. But here's the really important thing to notice here, is that it's not when I've described this kind of reasoning, it's not as if I'm talking about traces. Right? The explanation of how we know so much about a viridon-ferric salt child, which platypus, relied upon getting a molar and then inferring to the past. Here, I've got a couple of facts that I already know about sauropods, and I'm linking them together into some kind of coherent story. So I think this is a different kind of reasoning. And so that's the descriptive claim. Coherency plays a role in historical reconstruction. But this might worry you a bit. You might say, well, I don't really like coherency much. Coherency seems like an internal feature of an explanation or a hypothesis. It doesn't seem like it plays a directly evidential kind of role. Lots of people are kind of against the role of storytelling in historical reconstruction for sort of this reason. You might, for instance, compare the story I just told you about sauropods with the myth that I started the talk with. Right? There, we heard a just-so story about how it is that we got platypuses. You might say, hey, look, that story looks just as internally consistent or coherent as the story about sauropods. And that one, clearly, is not the sort of thing that we should think is a true story. And so, I just don't like coherency. And here's an example of someone saying this. Carol Cleland here is arguing that her story about historical science, which we'll meet towards the end of the talk, is preferable to one which emphasizes coherency. So she says, if the primary reason for accepting an historical hypothesis is its explanatory power, which is to say, we like the hypothesis because it explains well, and it draws its explanatory power primarily from the coherence and continuity of a quasi-fictional story. So some of those things in that network I knew pretty directly. I could find out how big the sauropod is by looking at its bones. But some of it, not very direct, right? We don't really have any direct access to the gut, to the sort of way that sauropod digestion worked, right? And so we're kind of filling in the gaps. And she says, well, if it's relying on this quasi-fictional coherency, historical science just seems inferior to experimental science. It seems like a bad way of doing things. Because in the absence of empirical warrant, a narrative explanation amounts to little more than a just-so story. So, similar to the story that I started the talk with. So the next section I'm going to respond to that kind of worry. What I'm going to do is two things. The first thing I'm going to do is give us a story about how historical evidence works, and then show that actually, in terms of evidence, this trace-based reasoning and this coherency is just the same, right? They both work the same sort of way. I'm then going to talk about how it is that coherency can provide so much success for these historical reconstructions. So the way I'm going to talk about evidence is in terms of what I call dependency relations. So here's a very simple story about a dependency relation. So some variable is minimally dependent on some other variable just when the first variable taking some value or range of values probabilistically changes the affects the likelihood of the other one taking a particular value or range of values. Right. So this is very, very simple. This is, you know, it's not saying anything causal, it's not directional in any particular way. So for instance, the relationship between the length of the sauropod leg, the fossil, and the length of this guy's leg, it seems like there's a minimal dependence between them in both directions. If I make this bigger or smaller, chances are this is going to be bigger or smaller, and vice versa. Right. So this is a very thin, I take it, notion of minimal of dependence. Later in the talk, at the very end, I'm going to play around with this for a bit, but at the moment I just need this simple notion. Now notice that when we're talking about traces, we're talking about dependency relations. I'm saying there's a minimal dependence, at least, between features of the molar and features of the platypus. But now think about the explanation we had of sauropod endothermy, of being gluttonous. It seems as if we were relying on a dependency relationship between two things in the past, right? We're not relying on a kind of trace-based dependency. We're relying on two properties that sauropods had, right? If they were hot-blooded, if they were endothermic, then they must have been gluttons. So there's an example of a dependency in the past.
And notice that evidential relevance here seems to work sort of the same way. I have a body of background theory which justifies me in taking these dependency relations, right? So when I'm thinking about the size of a sauropod, I have theory about how it is that fossilization works. And in virtue of that, I'm able to infer that. When I'm looking at the relationship between endothermy and eating a lot, I have theory about how thermoregulative systems work, and I rely on that. And so you have these dependencies in the world, and you have background theories in virtue of which they're evidentially relevant. Looks like I don't see any obvious difference, at least in that, at that level, between the two stories. Okay. So that's a really simple argument to just say, on the face of it, the coherency works the same way as the traces, right? So it's not coherency in any strong sense, it's just evidence which is holding between things in the past as opposed to a trace and a thing in the past. Now I want to talk about how it is that this reasoning is so successful. And I'm going to do this by switching from talk of dependency to talk of relationships between explanations or hypotheses. So it seems as if the explanation you gave of sauropod endothermy and sauropod eating a lot in this are kind of interdependent in a certain type of way. So two different explanations or hypotheses are interdependent, just in case, if you mention A, if you're trying to explain A, you've got to also talk about B. Right? Otherwise, you're not going to be giving a sufficient explanation. Now, explanatory sufficiency is an extremely difficult concept, and I'm not going to give you a full account of explanatory sufficiency here, but I'm going to sort of trace how this might go. So think about the explanation for sauropods having a long neck. We say, why do they have a long neck? Well, that enabled them to eat more food at less cost, and that enabled them to be gigantic. Now, a lot of the time when people are thinking about explanations, they're thinking about explanations in terms of contrasts. Something's a good explanation just in case it contrasts the thing we're interested from some relative set of other cases. As you may have picked up, one of the big contrasts when you're talking about sauropods are large mammals. And so me saying, well, sauropods can eat a lot because they have a long neck, isn't drawing a relative contrast, just saying that, doesn't draw the relevant contrast because it doesn't explain why mammals don't have a long neck. In order to give that explanation, I have to include the no chewing bit, right? Because it's that sauropods don't chew and mammals do that explains how sauropods got such a long neck. And so it seems as if I was going to give this explanation, just referring to the long neck, without referring to not chewing, that explanation would be, in some sense, less good, because what it's not doing is providing the relevant contrast between mammals and sauropods. And so when you have these interdependencies, it seems as if I'm sort of forced by explanatory sufficiency to link these things together. And this has an epistemic effect. The epistemic effect is one of mutual support. It's a kind of restricted kind of claim about evidential holism, right? If I get evidence about one aspect of the explanation, chances are that's going to boost the whole thing, right? And this, I think, explains how these things are so successful, right? When I have coupled evidence, coupled explanations, any new information I gain is going to have lots of effects throughout my general hypotheses and general theorizing. And so I've just argued that we can understand access to the past in terms of dependency relations. So these dependency relations are sometimes trace-based, like what we saw with the tooth, and they're sometimes based on things in the past, like what we saw with the sauropod. When you're an historical scientist, you're exploiting these dependencies. And this allows you to construct what I call interdependent explanations, and these have mutual support. There's this kind of evidential conduit that these interdependencies provide. Coherency, I've argued, doesn't seem to function differently in terms of evidential warrant. Remember, Carl Cleland said coherency is bad, whereas trace-based stuff's good because coherence is bad evidence. But so far as I can tell, the way that our coherence works is just the same as the way that our trace-based evidence works. And moreover, I've kind of argued that the hunt for these interdependencies are driven by the requirements of explanatory sufficiency. So it's because of these interdependence and because of this mutual support that historical scientists knit together all of these things in the past, and that makes for a lot more reach into the past than you would expect. If you were just looking at the relationships between traces, you would think that historical scientists wouldn't know very much in some contexts. But they can know a lot more than you would expect because of these coherency relations. And so, I argue, adherence to historical reconstruction is evidential. That's the second claim. Okay. Oh, there's a lot in this talk. Now I'm going to talk about method. So as I mentioned at the start, there have been a few people, philosophers, working on how it is you'd be an historical scientist. When you're a paleontologist, or a geologist, or an archaeologist, what kind of reasoning are you doing? These accounts are, as I mentioned, almost always trace-based. So I'm going to give you two examples. Now, so far as I can tell, it's illegal for me to do a talk on the philosophy of paleontology without mentioning the dinosaur extinction. So I'm going to discharge that obligation now. I'm not so much interested in the dinosaur extinction as the asteroid impact event, which usually you would say happened 65 million years ago, but I've noticed that people have started saying 66 million years ago in the last year or so. So I guess it's 66 million years ago now. So we've got very good reason to think that 66 million years ago, a great big rock hit the Earth, and this did something. This may or may not have caused the dinosaur extinction. That's a tricky question. How do we know this? Well, there are three bits of evidence. This is some shocked quartz. That's roughly what happens to quartz when it is put under enormous pressure. We've got a lot of shocked quartz forming 66 million years ago. This tells us that something really big happened. This is some iridium. Well, this is the layer, sorry. This is the layer where the extinction event occurs. This has a lot of iridium in it. Iridium is a mineral which is quite rare on Earth, but some asteroids are chock full of it. And so if you find a layer of iridium, this gives you reason to think that some extraterrestrial event occurred. So, great big thing happened, probably came from space. This is a paleomagnetic resonance image of a great big hole, a great big crater under the ocean out sort of near Mexico, which dates to 66 million years ago. So that, you know, is pretty good evidence, if you have to say, that a great big rock hit the Earth. The question that we want to ask is, well, what kind of reasoning are we doing here? Easily the most popular story about historical reconstruction relies on a common cause explanations. So Elliot Sober thinks this, Amy Tucker thinks this, and as we'll see, Carol Cleland has the most developed account of this. What's a common cause explanation? Well, it was a long time ago now, maybe 5 years ago or so, when I was doing my PhD. I came home to my flat late at night, and things were a bit weird. I kind of came into my flat, and I noticed that everything was a mess. And that's strange. I'm not particularly tidy, but my flatmate is. I also noticed that some items were missing. My banjo, for instance, was gone, which was rather striking, right? I usually keep good track of my banjo. Then when I walked into my room, I saw that the window was broken, which was also rather surprising, because, you know, commonly I don't go around breaking windows. Now, these three events happening at the same time is rather surprising. The flat being a mess, my banjo missing, and my window being broken. Very big coincidence these two happened at the same time. But of course I wasn't mystified at all. I immediately inferred that I'd been robbed. Right? How does that work? Well, I have three events, which are really surprising. It would be a real coincidence if they happened to occur at the same time. But I posit some event in the past, me being robbed or an asteroid hitting the Earth, which unifies them. Right? And so their conditional likelihood, given the event in the past, is significantly higher than their, you know, than their sort of strict probability. And this gives us a very strong evidential warrant for our hypothesis. Carol Cleland develops this kind of thought into what she calls the smoking gun approach. It works something like this. Imagine I find some shocked quartz. I think, wow, that's amazing, some shocked quartz. What could have caused that? And I posit a whole bunch of hypotheses in the past. For instance, an asteroid hitting the Earth could explain a shocked quartz, but so could increased volcanism, right? So if I have lots and lots of volcanoes going off, that's going to cause some shocked quartz. What I then do is I think, well, what's something that could tell the difference between those hypotheses, right? What could be a smoking gun to tell between them? Well, perhaps the iridium, which tells me that an extraterrestrial event has occurred. That's the sort of thing you'd expect if you have an asteroid strike, but not if you have volcanism. Ah, excellent. I've just managed to narrow down my range of hypotheses. And so that's how Carol Cleland thinks historical science works. The other view, which I've discussed a little bit, I think Alison Wiley has done some really nice work on, and most explicitly Patrick Forber and I think his name's Eric Griffith, have a paper where they argue explicitly that this other view is the way to be an historical scientist. Here we have what's called consilience. So instead of emphasizing sort of the similarity, a sort of continuity between our different events, when you're thinking about consilience, you're interested in the sources of evidence that we have. Here's a simple case of consilience. Imagine I'm interested in dating some object. I want to know how old it is. One way I might date that object is by looking at, say, a tree which I knew kind of grew around about the same time. I can count the tree rings. It's one way of getting a date. Or I could do carbon isotope analysis, right? I could look at how much carbon has decayed in that object. That also gives me a date. Now notice that these two methods rely on very different background theory, right? If you're counting tree rings, that relies on theory about how trees grow, right? If I'm doing carbon isotope analysis, that depends on physical theory. Now think what it would take for me to do these two methods of, you know, age, of testing the age of this thing, and for them to be wrong, but come out with the same result. Right? For that to happen, both of them would need to screw up in different ways, and yet still converge on the same result. That's extremely unlikely. Right? It seems a lot more likely that if I have them converge, their results converging, that they're converging on the right answer. And so this is another example of how it is that by using different types of evidence, I can really boost my hypothesis. And then we have two stories about the method of historical science. On one view, we say historical hypotheses are supported primarily by unifying traces. If you're an historical scientist, you're looking for smoking guns. The other view says that historical hypotheses are primarily supported by consilience. What you're doing is you're hunting independent evidence streams. That's what you're in the business of doing. Now, you may wonder whether these are actually different. I wonder about that myself. But one thing that's certainly similar about them is they both emphasize trace evidence. So here's Forbert and Griffith. They say consilience provides the resources to successfully explain puzzling extent traces from fossils to radiation signatures. So what is consilience doing? It's explaining traces. Here's Carl Cleland. Hypotheses concerning long past token events are typically evaluated in terms of their capacities to explain puzzling associations among traces discovered through fieldwork. In other words, you're going and looking at these traces and saying, oh wow, these are really weird, what could unify them in the past? In both cases, the dependency relationships that they're focusing on are ones like the one between the tooth and the platypus. It's this trace-based evidence. I've given you another story, right? I've argued that historical hypotheses are supported by coherence. And if you're a historical scientist, you're going and looking for these interdependent explanations. Now, one thing you might wonder is, do I want to argue that this is where the real action is, as opposed to smoking guns or consilience? I think that would be a mistake, right? It would be silly to argue that they don't do this and they don't do this. Of course they do. But I think it would be equally silly to say they don't do this. It strikes me the sort of lesson we should draw here is that there's no essence to historical reconstruction. There's no method to it. There is rather a range of different methods that you apply in different contexts. In other words, you're a methodological omnivore. So, in case you don't know, some animals are obligates. So, for instance, big cats are usually carnivorous obligates. So, if you're a big cat, you just eat meat, that's it. Or you can be an omnivore, rather like us or a bear, where you kind of eat whatever you can find to some extent, right? So these views are kind of assuming that historical scientists are obligates, that if you're a historical scientist, there's one method. I'm going to argue instead that there is no archetypical methodology. Historical scientists are opportunists. What they do is they apply whatever method is effective depending on the extent of context. And moreover, you need to see that in order to understand how historical science can be so powerful. It's, you know, one thing that I love about historical scientists, paleontologists, archaeologists, so on and so forth, is the way that they just kind of grab whatever bits of theory, whatever tools they can, in order to reconstruct the past, right? It's a very, very messy, and I think wonderful group of sciences. And I think that very messiness explains their success. But this might worry you a bit if you're a philosopher, because a lot of the time, when you're a philosopher, you kind of want to unify stuff, right? You want to systematize things in various ways. And I just argue that historical scientists do a lot of stuff. And that might be kind of dissatisfying. So what do you do, when you're an historical scientist, when you're a philosopher, and you're facing these kind of disunified sciences. Well, I think there is systematization to be had, but you have to approach it in a different kind of way. What you do is you pick out various epistemic contexts, and you explain how the various methods apply in those contexts. So I'm going to give you a sort of quick sketch of how this might go. Remember our dependency relations, right? There's a minimal dependency between two variables, just in case changing one makes it likely that the other one changes. It seems like we can do more than just talk about minimal dependence. One thing we might think about is whether or not different types of dependencies give you more or less epistemic access to the past. And then whether or not what kind of dependencies I have make a difference to what method I should apply. So let's quickly do this now. I'm going to give you sort of three dimensions that you might use to understand these dependency relations. So the first I'm going to call how enmeshed your dependencies are. So this is just to say the number of dependencies. We're not talking about how strong they are or anything, it's just how many there are. Here, we have a very enmeshed bunch of properties, right? Nocturing is related to having a long neck and gigantism and having a huge digestive system. This is a very enmeshed little network. And this is good, because in virtue of this, evidence or information I get about, say, having a long neck is also going to tell me about gigantism and having a big digestive system and not chewing, right? So this enmeshed dependencies is something we really want. Dependencies can also be more or less informative. They can be more or less specific. Here I'm going to rely on a notion of specificity, which was developed by Ken Waters and Jim Woodward, drawing on David Lewis's work. I'm not going to give you the technical version, because let's face it, there's quite a lot in this talk already, but I'll give you the intuitive idea. Think about the difference between a volume knob on your stereo and the on-off switch on your stereo. The on-off switch has two states, and it doesn't really tell you anything very specific about your stereo, right? It tells you roughly whether or not it's playing the music, right? So if I play around with these switches, this doesn't give me all that much information. The volume knob, however, has a mapping between changes in the knob and the volume of my stereo. And so if I know the position of my volume knob, that gives me much more specific information than what I get just from the on-off switch. And so specificity is a way of thinking about how much information you gain when you get information about some system. And it seems as if highly specific dependencies are going to give me a lot of information. So that's a good thing. The third dimension is I'm just going to call strength. And this is just how much it boosts probability, how likely changing in one variable makes a change in the other variable. As an example, think about the relationship between being a glutton and being hot-blooded. Now, if you know something's a glutton, if you know that something eats a lot of food, this seems to tell us that, you know, it could be endothermic. You know, it gives us reason to believe it's endothermic, but there may be lots of reasons why you might be a glutton. It might just be you like food, it might be for other biological reasons, maybe you have to use a lot of energy doing something else. You know, sure, being a glutton doesn't really guarantee being hot-blooded. But now think about the relationship in the other direction. The relationship between being hot-blooded and being a glutton. If you're hot-blooded, you've got to eat a lot of food, right? If you're an endotherm, there's really no way of avoiding needing to take in a lot more food than if you're an ectotherm. And so actually, there's a very strong dependency relationship in this direction. The relationship between being a glutton and being hot-blooded is weaker than the relationship between being hot-blooded and being a glutton, right? And so we've got these three ways of understanding dependencies. We've got how enmeshed they are, how specific the information is, and how strong the support is, how strong the dependency relationship is. And I think this can tell us a little bit about what sort of method historical scientists should apply in these different contexts. Because think about the relationship between Obdurodontharic Schoolchild's tooth and the animal in the past. First note that they're highly embedded, right? If we change facts about Obdurodontharic Schoolchild's teeth, this changes the likelihood of it being a platypus, this changes whether it's a new species of platypus or not, it changes what size it is, and it tells us, changes what diet it might have, right? And so there's a lot of dependency relationships there. It's also very specific. In mammals, there's a pretty strict mapping between size of tooth and size of body. And so, so the relationship is more like a dial than a switch. as I change the size of the tooth, I'm going to change the size of the critter in the past. So I get lots of information. The dependencies are also very strong. The paleontologists take the symmetry between the talon and the trigonin, you know, the two features of your molars, as just unambiguously indicating platypuswood. If you got that, you're a platypus. Right? And so this is an extraordinarily rich bit of trace, right? And it seems like when we're in these kinds of contexts, when we expect to find embedded, specific, and strong dependencies, then we should probably do sort of smoking gun kind of stuff, right? I should expect to find these great big bits of evidence which are going to unambiguously decide between different hypotheses. And I think this explains why views like Carl Cleland's look really good when you're thinking about things like great big rocks hitting the Earth and mammoth teeth, which are extremely specialized. But it doesn't look as good when we think about the case I've talked about, when we talked about when we've asked why whether sauropods are endothermic or not, or how it was they ate so much. Here, the dependency relationships aren't as strong, right? And they're certainly not as specific. There's still a lot of embeddedness around. And it seems like when you have a lot of embeddedness, then it seems like the right approach is something like what I've leant on, this idea of really looking for coherency and looking for interdependencies. And so it seems as if we can say these guys are methodological omnivores, quite happily. And then also still do some philosophical work. I can do some systematization and explain, why certain methods would be applied in different contexts. So I've argued for three claims, broadly speaking. The descriptive claim, I've said, hey, look, when you're a historical scientist, you care about coherency, it plays a role. I've made a normative claim. I've said, I've given an account of coherence in historical reconstruction, and roughly argued that it's not really coherency per se. It's not like you have to appeal to some coherency story of evidence in order to see this. It just works the same way as trace-based evidence does, right? It's just a matter of picking out dependency relations. I've also then made a claim about method. I've argued that historical scientists are methodological omnivores, which is to say, we shouldn't think that there's one particular way of doing historical science. In fact, to understand why it works so well, you have to see how opportunistic they are. And so remember that I've been trying to answer sort of two questions. And again, this is only part of the story. To explain the success of historical science in terms of its method, we can't just focus on traces. That's going to provide a really, really impoverished story. We're going to be able to explain cases like the platypus. But it's not really going to capture the way that historical scientists are reasoning when they're thinking about, say, sauropods. And so by embracing this kind of pluralism, we're able to explain how it is that historical scientists are so successful. And that's the talk.
If they're supported in some way, leads to kind of coupled confirmation.
Right.
It rang a bell for me in terms of thinking about Lakatos's theories of proof versus refutation and how that works. And I don't know if this kind of provides you with some extra machinery to use or
Could you tell me a bit about what? I'm not that familiar with Lakatos's.
So he has this idea. He takes his whole list. Idea of how scientific theories work. So you've got sort of a hardcore kind of views that you're not willing to give up.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a Duhem type situation, is how I think about it. And then you've got a bunch of auxiliary hypotheses that that kind of come into that. And together, these things give you and enable you to make predictions about your target system and things like that.
Right.
He makes this point at some point that that there's kind of an asymmetry between support confirmation cases and refutation cases. So if your combination of theory and hypotheses predict a novel fact and that fact turns out to be true, then it provides support for both your hardcore of your theory and the auxiliary hypotheses. But if that novel fact turns out to be false, it's not clear where the blame lies, and it doesn't seem to affect the theory much at all. It struck me that there may well be something similar going on in this case, where you've got your different kinds of confirmation, your different explanations, if they're coupled in the right way, should you find some piece of kind of confirming evidence for one of them, it's going to be quite strong support for all of them. But if you kind of get something that doesn't quite fit with that, then it's going to be difficult to see where the blame lies. It just seemed like there was...
That's a really interesting thought. So I take it, I mean, one way in which it's different from what Lakatos is doing is that Lakatos, of course, is very macro scale, right? He's sort of talking about, he's thinking about sciences in a very kind of idealized kind of way, where this is much more local, right? I'm thinking about how you reconstruct a sauropod as opposed to some grand theory of paleontology. But I think there's something really interesting in the question of, you know, because I was just thinking about, and in fact, I've only been really thinking about confirming cases, at least in this talk, and it strikes me that there is a kind of odd asymmetry where when I get evidence against, I kind of, in my head, I can see how you would, how the positive evidence kind of ricochets through the network. But it's not obvious to me what happens when you get sort of negative evidence in these cases. I need to think a lot more about whether or not that relationship is symmetrical or not. My immediate reaction is to say something like, look, I'm roughly a Bayesian. This is going to decrease or increase my greens to some extent. But it might be more... A more interesting question, like I think even if you've got that kind of relatively simplistic view of evidence, it still seems like there's a question about, well, imagine if we find out that sauropods didn't chew, for instance, or at least some sauropods chewed. It's going to be quite difficult to sort of proportion blame in that kind of case, like who, you know, how much should I dislike these various parts of this network? I'm not sure whether you'd be able to say anything very systematic about that. But you're right that there's a definite connection between the sort of holism that Lakatos is talking about, because one thing that's nice about it is that it's kind of a restricted kind of holism. It's not just, you know, some kind of giant Quinean claim. It's much more like about the specific theories that you're wearing, auxiliary hypotheses you're working with. But I do think a lot more about whether there's anything sort of systematic you can say about whether there are differences between confirmation and disconfirmation when you're thinking about independencies in this way. I mean, one thing you might worry about is I occasionally think about what you might call an evidential bottleneck. So you have this one thing that's kind of in this position in your theory that's doing a huge amount of work, right? So imagine, so it seems like in this thing, the sauropods not chewing is doing a lot of work, right? If we find out that they all chew or something like that, suddenly it looks like the whole thing seems to collapse. And so if you do get these sort of bottleneck effects, then disconfirmation could have very different effects to confirmation, where confirmation, I just feel a little bit better about stuff. Disconfirmation, everything's good, right? I don't know how often you get these bottlenecks or not. I don't think you really have them in the sauropod case, for instance. But yeah, there's a lot to think about there.
Yeah, so it's not quite your project, but it strikes me that those kinds of cases could be really open to, like, kind of, the really formal kind of analysis, like the Bayesian causal network type analysis, like what Kevin Coleman, what Jan Spring, or people like that,
right,
might be really interested in trying to look at those cases in a much more formal way. I don't know.
Yeah, so someone's told me that the story I have about coherency actually breaks Bayes theorem, which worries me a lot, because I just work on the assumption that whatever I say is at a level such that really doesn't matter what account of evidence you have. Some sort of long-term project would definitely be looking at ways of sort of formalizing the sort of reasoning I'm talking about. I am not the dude to do that. It's, I think, a really interesting thing to play with to see how the sort of view on coherency works on these different evidential things, formal theories of evidence. Maybe two things to say about that, though. One is I'm very moved by John Morton's work on formalizations of evidence, which basically says, look, there's no one way of thinking about evidence. The way that you think about evidence is highly context sensitive. So sometimes a statistical perception of evidence is going to be really good, but that's, you know, if you're in a statistical, where the context where statistics works, right? So I don't know what the quote is from, but, you know, I'm not a Bayesian, but if I'm going to the casino, I'm going to be a Bayesian, right? But, one problem with sort of what we would gain from formalizing this is that, if it doesn't work,
one thing you might say is, oh well, this just shows us that this is a context where this way of formalizing evidence isn't very helpful. So that's one thing to worry about. It's really interesting.
I have a very general question, and that concerns, you said that in general archaeologists, paleontologists, and so forth are opportunists, but I was wondering if you could say something more about the respects in which these practicing scientists, so to speak, actually care about kind of these philosophical, epistemological questions. And I'm thinking kind of similar features even within the field of history, where some historians just write history books and don't really care about philosophy of history or whether they can prove any of this, because within the field of history, what makes for evidence is very different than within the field of philosophy or epistemology or whatever. So, and I'm guessing, and I don't know all of the figures you referred to, but probably all of them are philosophers and not necessarily practicing archaeologists or paleontologists. So, just generally speaking, when one looks at descriptive, normative, and methodological questions, do the scientists care about this in the way that philosophers would like them to?
Right? It really depends on your scientist, of course. Generally speaking, I think Carol Cleland's work perhaps does a better job than mine of connecting these issues directly with the sorts of things that scientists tend to care about. So her entry point is contrasting experimental science and historical science. So what she's kind of arguing is, look, there are lots of scientists who have said things like, oh, paleontology isn't really a science because it doesn't have experiments in it, right? And her approach is to say, well, actually, there's this whole other way of doing science, the smoking gun methodology, which is just as legit, right? And so her concern is really establishing the legitimacy of historical science against these kinds of complaints. And that's a complaint that's primarily made, well, to some extent made by scientists, right? Scientists tend to worry a lot about when a scientist isn't a physicist, they tend to worry a lot about the legitimacy of their science. And so when you can sort of recast all the stuff I've been saying in those terms, right, where I'm sort of arguing that, look, if you're worried about whether or not what you're doing is like scientific in some sense, here I'm giving you a story which legitimizes this kind of practice. In terms of whether or not, so there's two things about, so the question about whether or not scientists care, there's a sort of psychological question, but maybe a more interesting question, which is something like, does this provide any insights for the scientists? Like, for instance, am I able to take this kind of framework and go to a scientist and say, oi, you know, here's how you should do your science. There are some upshots here, I think, for how we do science. So one upshot that I've argued for is it actually, this kind of picture gives speculation a really important role in how we go about being scientists. So one thing that I really like about paleontology, and I think paleontologists get a bit upset when I say this, because they are very careful, but nonetheless, paleontology seems to have a lot more speculation in it than lots of other sciences. And here I'm talking about what they in fact publish. And I think the reason for this is because when you're hunting for these interdependencies, you need to formulate hypotheses, right? You need to kind of get these things on the table before you're able to work out how to test them, right? So as soon as you sort of see this link, for instance, between chewing and having a long neck, as soon as you see that, this leads to a whole bunch of other studies you might do. For instance, you might want to check whether it's true that in mammals there's a restriction on how small your head can be relative to your body, right? There's a new way of kind of testing, getting evidential kind of whack onto that set of hypotheses. And so one of the things that comes maybe not directly out of this talk, but combined with some other stuff, is a sort of position on the importance of speculation. And I think that's something which has a direct bearing on what sorts of things you should be willing to publish, for instance, if you're a scientist working in these fields. So I think there are sort of upshots, but I think that they are somewhat indirect.
Thanks. So, you know, two questions. The one probably, and referring to your analogy with the robbery episode and the way you infer and referring to the past. Mm-hmm. So there is there. This analogy clear similarity between the two situations, in which, of course, you have all these pieces of evidence in both, but you have a clear, let's say, a uniformity of conditions in where you infer in the robbery episode. Yes, you already say you know them quite well, quite better than in case of the past. Yes, where you infer to a unique event which you cannot compare. Usually you are missing a lot of evidence and of conditions at that point, so your inference is quite weaker from it. So, in this sense, this is, I don't know if you...
Yeah, may I respond to that? And we'll
get
back to that.
Yeah.
I absolutely agree. And in fact, argue in other places that this is one of the reasons why we should be suspicious of claims like Carl Cleland's that puts a lot of weight on common cause explanations. I think that the sort of formalization or the sort of theory behind a common cause explanation is, so far as these things go, relatively straightforward. There is a very complicated formal debate about how we should think about these things and how they work, but nonetheless, the intuitive idea is pretty straightforward. It's a kind of reasoning we use all the time. But I think that's kind of seductive, because, as you say, a lot of the time, that's really not that good. I mean, I think in the, you know, you can kind of cherry pick your cases. So in the, did a big block hit the Earth 66 million years ago? Yeah, it did. It would be completely insane if a big rock didn't hit the Earth 66 million years ago. But if you want to ask, what role did that big rock play in the dinosaur extinction? Super hard. If you want to ask, well, what was it, a Tuesday or a Wednesday that it hit the Earth? Super hard, right? As we get asked sort of different questions, common cause explanation becomes a lot weaker, and for just the sorts of reasons you're saying. So I completely agree with you, and that's one of the reasons why focusing on common cause explanations, like most philosophers, and to be honest, to go back to Michael's question briefly, scientists, so when historical scientists talk about what they talk about it in terms of traces. Right? If you look at like a kid's book that a scientist has written about dinosaurs, when they explain their method, they say we get some fossils and then we learn about animals, right? And I think that that view is extremely impoverished, because in the masses and masses of situations, we're unlucky. We don't have these really strong dependency relations, or we don't have very good background theory to sort of pick those dependencies out. And in those cases, I think coherence and to a lesser extent consilience plays a lot more of a role, right? So I agree.
And the second one was, you said that the historical scientists are opportunistic. So I'm wondering if also other sciences are not also opportunistic. I mean, especially when you go to fields where you don't know nothing and you have to grab whatever you have to do something there, you know?
Yeah, I definitely don't think that the claim about methodological omnivory is something which is unique to historical science. In fact, I'm very confident it's not. I do think that there's an interesting difference between certain types of sciences that you might call experimental, where they do kind of look like they're obligates. So if you are working on a model organism, for instance, you're in the business of looking at that organism. You've got a very sort of, in a sense, it's kind of not messy, right? You're like, what am I doing? I'm trying to find out how a zebrafish's heart works. How am I doing that? Well, I'm designing this little camera that lets me view its heart, and here's my kind of experimental setup, and here's how I'm going to do it. And it seems like in these circumstances, your strategy when you're a scientist is to kind of mine this rich seam of information. But in other cases, like a lot of the time when you're a paleontologist, or I think if you're an ecologist, or perhaps someone in economics, or these other range of sciences where you don't have this rich source of information, you then have to cast about and grab whatever you can. So I think that this point about methodological omnivory is, I think, very applicable to other sciences, particularly things like, say, ecology or parts of biology. Yes.
How old is this type of, I mean, I would imagine something like this until like the 21st century or something like that, paleontology was strictly the smoking guns type of methodology or reduced it, right? I mean, is it the fact that this science is omnivorous, is it a new thing or an old thing? I mean, I'm curious about one particular case. Mm-hmm. There's this case about that dinosaur, the iguana, right? Which kind of scientists thought in the 20th century that it had like a horn on his nose, right? And it kind of, you kind of know now that the horn was on his mouth, right? How did it got overturned? How did it got refuted?
Right.
I mean, did they found some hard evidence like a skeleton of iguana which had like a...
Good, listen, so first off, the question about whether or not this is a relatively recent development in paleontology or not is a really interesting one that I haven't thought about before. So thank you, that's really interesting. So one thing that you would say is that paleontology in particular has gotten a lot more things it can be an omnivore about in the last 25 years, right? We've got molecular data now, we have a lot, our computers are much more powerful, right? Our capacity to build these epistemic tools have become significantly more powerful. And so you'd expect, given that we have all of these funky new tools, that there'd be more of this omnivory going on. And I think that's actually quite interesting, right? That can kind of explain how it is that paleontology has done so well in the last 25 or 30 years. So, interestingly, there's a kind of view on the history of paleontology, which I think is extremely idealized, but it says something like, up until the sort of 60s and 70s, paleontology was the handmaiden of geology. If you're a paleontologist, you hung out in the geology department, and you helped geologists organize strata, right? So you've got the layers of rock, and you go, oh look, I've got the same type of fossil in this layer, so they're at the same time period, right? And that was all the paleontologists did. Of course, it wasn't, but that was this kind of view. And then in the 60s and 70s, you have what has been called in a relatively recent book, The Paleobiological Revolution, where paleontology started to take itself seriously as a theoretical science. And interestingly, this happened about the same time as they started doing things on computers. Right? They started using simulations and crunching numbers, right? And using big data sets, things like that. And so, it's interesting, so, I mean, there might be a way of tacking the sort of things I've seen onto that kind of historical story, but that would involve someone who knew more about the history of the science than I do. But that's a really, really interesting line of inquiry. In terms of the Iguanodon, I don't actually know the specifics of the case. I don't know anything more than you do, which is they had this kind of hilarious sort of quadruped with this big horn, and now it's this bipedal thing with horns on its thumbs. I don't know the specifics of how they switch from one to the other. One thing that has happened quite a lot in the history of paleontology is relying on really bad analogs. So one case is the duck-billed dinosaurs. So they were originally thought to be aquatic because they reconstructed their feet as being webbed. Right? They thought,
why?
They thought that they were a bit like ducks. Right? It's pretty simple. And this kind of affected how they reconstructed these animals for a really long time. And then, you know, they realized that actually that was the wrong analog, and actually they're more like camels, they had some paddle feet. And so Derek Turner had some arguments where he suggests that there's a real problem with using analogies in historical reconstruction because it has these sort of problems. You can be misled quite easily. So, yeah, I don't know about the Iguanodon case specifically. And nor do I know whether it was, I can take the question is, well, did they find a new trace? Right? Then it would be the smoking gun story.
Right.
Or did they, for instance, learn more about how it is you should reconstruct these things? Or did they learn something over here which somehow had a dependency relation, which meant it must have been bipedal? I simply don't know, but that would be an interesting test case to see how far back in time the story goes. Next Thursday, the Institute will be running a workshop on models in science for these students. So that you can't see that at all, can you? It's called Simplification and Distortion as a Scientific Strategy. And so from roughly 9:15 through to 5:30 or so on Thursday, so not tomorrow but in a week, there'll be a really fun workshop on idealization in science. So if you can come, that'll be fun.
And there is a program out
Yeah. That really didn't work.